Hi everyone, happy Monday from a very rainy and cold, well not cold, it's around maybe 55 or 60, so it's not too bad, but it's rainy and windy today. They were even talking about hail in some parts of Southern California. Fingers crossed we don't get one here, a hailstorm that is, but not complaining about the rain. It's absolutely glorious and the garden is greening up. It just looks so amazing outside. I walked out for a little bit, got a few clips, which you might have seen on my Instagram this morning, but it just felt glorious, even greener than it was on the garden tour. So hopefully you all were able to catch the March garden tour. But welcome, so glad that you're here. And if you live in Southern California, let me know how your garden is holding up to the rain. We are loving it. Thanks to those of you that are joining me from other parts of the world. We do have people from all over the world here today. So welcome. And if you're still in winter and bitterly cold weather, hang in there, you guys. It is officially spring, but I know Jack in Maryland was saying it's bitterly cold. It's 20 degrees and snowing. So hang in there. I'm sending all the Southern California warmth I possibly can your way. Hang on, I gotta make some adjustments here on my computer. And we are in the midst of our raised bed garden series and just having a great time getting things planted. So yesterday, my strategy to take advantage of the rain was to get outside and plant as many seeds as I could. I want to have a beautiful flower garden this year, so I planted tons of zinnia seeds. I planted nasturtiums. You see some nasturtiums growing right behind me here. I had to bring a lot of my plants inside because of the wind. And sunflowers, beans, you might have seen my Instagram post on that. So it's a great strategy to take advantage when you are getting rain, is just plant seeds and the rain does the work for you and makes your job so much easier. So with that being said, let's say hello and happy Monday to those of you that are here in the chat. Char Mack, hello from rainy Seattle. You're probably very used to rain. We're not used to it here, so it's a really big event when it does happen. Jay Tony was mentioning that he planted all day yesterday and is writing a book. So Jay, congratulations. I know exactly how that feels because I just finished a book myself. So good luck, hang in there, take it one day at a time and you got this. You're gonna finish it and it's gonna be a great success. And I believe that camera guy is here in the chat. So welcome. I always love it when Jerry can hop on his lunch break. So make sure that you welcome him as well. And didn't he do a great job filming our garden tour, guys? We always have fun when we film together. He's been working a lot, so I've been filming a lot of my own videos, but he was home, so he was able to film it. I think he did a fabulous job. A lot of you said that you really enjoyed it. Irene is here. Charlene Mitchell is here. Nisha and Cliff, of course, are here, our faithful moderators every single week. Asha from Texas. My Backyard Gourds is here. Lillian from Georgia. The Healing Berry Garden from Germany. Melody Sam, how are you? From Maryland. And Shatista from Virginia. Great to have everyone. And Miriam from Chicago. And I know a lot of Chicago people on before the live stream were saying it's super cold in Chicago. So today's live stream is all about raised bed mistakes you do not want to make. So we've been talking about raised beds a lot lately. And of course, we're in the middle of our raised bed garden series. Raised beds are just such a fun and easy way to grow, taking the world by storm. So today I want to talk about some mistakes that you don't want to make, mistakes you definitely want to avoid when you're growing in raised beds. And then in between the tips, how it works on the live streams if you're new is, in between the tips, I'll jump into the chat, so get your questions ready, and I'll answer as many questions as I possibly can throughout the live stream. So we always have a great time here. Okay, so the first mistake that you don't want to make when you are starting raised bed gardening, especially for your first time gardeners, is putting your raised bed in the wrong location in your yard. Now, what do I mean by that? You want to maximize the sun exposure of your raised beds because, of course, most vegetables grow best when they have about 6 to 8 hours of sunlight. So you really want to get your raised bed in the best place in your yard. A lot of times people will put it in the wrong location. It'll get shaded out, or you know, it's just not getting the sun that it needs to really grow and thrive. And then you wonder, why am I not getting any vegetables from my raised bed? So you really want to maximize your sun exposure. Now, a little tip you can do, and I actually talked about this in my first book, Organic Gardening for Everyone, is if you're considering growing in raised beds, you're not quite sure where to put them, what you can do is stake out about a 4x8 section of your yard. Because that's about the typical size of a raised bed. So look for a spot in your yard that has what you think has the most sun exposure. And just put 4 stakes in the corner, a 4x8 area in each corner. And then just keep an eye on it for a couple of days. Now that the time has changed and we're now in the spring equinox, we're getting a few more hours of sunlight each day. So keep an eye on that spot throughout the day. See where the shadows fall. See how much sun exposure it gets. And just watch it for a few days. And if it gets shaded like by noon, you might want to try and find another spot in your yard where that gets more sun exposure. But if it gets a full 6 to 8 hours or more, then you've really found the sweet spot for your raised beds. Now, that being said, you don't always have to get a full consecutive 6 to 8 hours. Maybe you get 3 or 4 hours in the morning, and then it goes behind like your house or whatever, and then peeks out behind your house, and you get a few more hours later in the day. That's perfectly okay. So do look for the spot with the most sun exposure possible. Now, try and avoid, if you can, if space allows, placing your raised bed near like structures like right up against your house or, you know, near trees, things like that. Because that's going to cast some shadows on your raised bed. But like I said, that being said, don't worry about it if you don't have the ideal space. We don't have a huge, humongous yard with no trees. We live in an urban setting. So I just put my raised beds wherever I possibly can. Of course, I want to get them in the best possible spot, but there are several areas that are shaded where I have raised beds. And then you'll just want to adjust the type of vegetables that you plant in those raised beds if you can, so that you're planting vegetables that can tolerate the shade or the sun or whatever the situation might be. So you also want it to be easily accessible to a water supply. That's probably one of these the most critical things about, besides the sunlight, about the placement of your garden. I know for us, we don't have, when we first built our yard, the hose bib was quite far away, but we did have to extend and bring some hoses down to our garden, the sloped area of our garden, so that we could easily access water and drip irrigation. You know, if it's close to water, you're a lot more likely to go out and water your garden or, you know, attach drip irrigation to your garden beds. But if you have to lug, you know, a hose and buckets of water, watering cans, you know, quite a distance, you're not going to be as likely to really be consistent with your watering. So in the sun and close to a water source as much as possible. Now, you do also want to orient your garden beds in the northern hemisphere anyway, from north to south. So your garden beds, if possible, if your space allows, orient them facing south, because that's going to be where you're going to get the most amount of sun exposure. So choosing the correct location or the best location possible for your raised beds is really critical to getting good harvest. So hopefully by following some of these tips, you can avoid a very, very common mistake that a lot of first-time gardeners make. Now, I do cover this in my new book. So most of you know my new book is on raised bed gardening, and I do cover a lot of these tips here in my book. I have a whole section on the location for your raised beds. So if you don't have this, definitely grab it. There were some people emailing me asking when are they going to get their book. If you ordered, the exciting thing is it's only about 2 weeks away from releasing. So if you order on Amazon or Barnes & Noble or somewhere else besides my website, the official release date is April 12th, which is about 2 weeks away. So you'll be getting it on or around that date. If you ordered a signed copy on my website, I'll be mailing those out next week. So you'll get them around the second week of April as well. So pretty exciting. It's almost here. And I don't know if you saw my Instagram post on, I think it was Sunday. We're having a book launch event. So it's really exciting. A local nursery garden center that's family owned is hosting our book event. Book launch. It's a beautiful, beautiful garden center. If you live anywhere in Southern California, it's called Topanga Nursery. It's in Chatsworth, California, And it is just like a little spot of heaven there in Chatsworth. So if you live anywhere in the area, we want to invite you to come on down, meet Camera Guy and I. We want to meet you guys. It's on April 24th, which is a Sunday at 1 o'clock. It's going to go from about 1 to 3, and you're going to absolutely love it. It's going to be a lot of fun. We'll be doing giveaways, prizes, book signings, and you can just wander around the gorgeous grounds of the Garden Center. So go over and check out all the details on my Instagram at CallieKim29, and we cannot wait to meet you there. Okay, let me jump into the chat here, guys, and fire away. Ask me your raised bed garden questions. I think I mentioned that it's raining. Yes, I did. That's why I'm here in my office today. I love to usually stream out in the garden, but obviously the rain doesn't allow for that today. So hopefully next week we'll be back outside. Okay, let's see here, guys. What kinds of questions do we have? Anisha posted all the info about the book launch there in the chat. You can go over and check out Topanga Nursery's Instagram as well. Give them a follow, send them some love, leave them a comment. They're just a wonderful family. We love them, and we've really gotten to be friends with them over the past couple of years. Terry is saying, can't wait to get the new book. Thank you so much, Terry. I'm excited for y'all to read it. And Deb and Jack Garden Adventures, welcome. So glad you're here today. Hello, Kim from Ohio. Very cold and snowy here. Can't wait for my raised beds to get up. Yeah, I bet you're just absolutely chomping at the bit, itching for warm weather, itching for spring. And hopefully very, very soon you'll be out there gardening and having a great time in the warm sun. Charlene says, let me book a flight to the U.S. Yeah, come on over, Charlene. We would love to have you, and we would love to meet you there. Maybe sometime we'll get over in your neck of the woods. I think you're in Spain, right? Is that correct? We would love to visit Spain. We've never been there. That would be a lot of fun. Okay, let's see. Who else has a question? Lorraine is walking in the rain. We're a rare occurrence in Central Cali. We're so happy for the rain today. You got that right. Rachel says, wish I could put beds in the back with the sun, but all I get is burning due to it being a sun trap. So I only get the front, which gets less sun. Any tips? Okay, so is it maybe because you have more concrete structures or something like that in the back? Is that why you're getting so much more heat back there? What you could do is possibly use some shade cloth. That's a really good strategy when you get too much heat. Or maybe you just put some really heat tolerant vegetables, excuse me, in the back that can really take the heat. Kale and chard are pretty good with heat. You could plant, look for some more heat tolerant varieties of tomatoes. There's some good other heat tolerant greens, like a New Zealand spinach. Some greens from my heat tolerant seed collection are very, very heat tolerant. I do have a new one in my, no, I don't think I have that one in there just yet. Malabar spinach, is that my specialty greens? I'm trying to remember. I have so many seeds now, I can't remember. But Malabar spinach is also a very, very heat tolerant green, very similar to the spinach look and flavor, but it's a vining variety and it's a beautiful plant. So I would kind of go with that, either some heat tolerant greens or use shade cloth, which is absolutely a lifesaver. Okay, let's see here. Terry, great question here. How high should you have your soil in raised beds? All the way to the top. And I do cover that in my new book as well, Terry. But quick answer is yes, I definitely like to fill my raised beds when I can, when I have enough soil, all the way to the top, because what happens is a lot of times it will settle over time. The soil will settle, and I covered this on my refresh your soil video last week. I mentioned the soil will settle, or if you're using organic products, organic amendments in your soil, such as leaves or things like that, a lot of times they will break down and your soil will settle over time. So get it as full as you possibly have enough soil for. If it's a few inches from the top or whatever, it's really no big deal, but just keep in mind that it could, the sides of the raised bed where your vegetables are small, if your soil is real low, it could kind of shade things out just a little bit, but you know, usually they catch up over time. So great question here. Okay, April, good question from you here. Would it be better to cut sticks in smaller pieces? I have bushes I cut down and that I want to use in my raised bed garden. Any tips? Okay, that's a great way actually to minimize the amount of soil that you have to buy to really make the most of your soil is to fill the bottom of your raised beds with organic materials that you might have around your yard. So tree branches, leaves, sticks, twigs are a great thing to kind of bulk up your raised bed so you don't have to use as much soil. And definitely it will help them break down quicker if you can get them in smaller pieces. So always a good way to go if you're able to do that, and that way it breaks down and adds organic matter to the soil over time. So really good, good way to do that. And I cover all that in my book too. There's a whole section on soil in there and how to fill your beds for cheap. So there's just unlimited resources there in my book. Okay, so let's jump back into the second mistake that a lot of brand new raised bed gardeners make, and that is planting too much. Okay, when you're a new gardener, you really want to keep it simple. And the reason for that is, if you plant too much, what ends up happening is a lot of times you just get way, way overwhelmed. You get in a little bit over your head and you start feeling like, oh my gosh, I just can't do this. It's way too much to take care of. So what I like to tell people is to start simple and expand later. If you have my first book, there's a whole section on that in there as well. So what happens if you get too overwhelmed, a lot of times you just kind of quit, you give up, you're not able to maintain your raised beds. Maybe you have disease issues and pest issues that come in and take over, and you just end up quitting. So avoid that mistake by starting simple. You don't have to plant like tons and tons of vegetables your first year. Just start with one raised bed. And a good way to kind of figure out like how much do I need to plant is consider, are you trying to be, you know, just kind of to supplement your raised bed garden or supplement your, you know, the produce that you buy at the grocery store? Or are you trying to be self-sufficient? Most first-time gardeners will have a really tough time if they start off trying to be self-sufficient. So I highly recommend starting simple. Start with maybe a small kitchen garden, maybe just one raised bed, and plant things that you will eat and harvest daily. So that's a good way just to have, you know, get it under your belt a little bit, get some success, learn some new skills. And then once you get that first harvest, then the next growing season or the next time you plant, you can always add a couple of additional raised beds. Now in my book, I cover that as well. And that is right here is your goal to be self-sufficient or to just supplement what you're already, supplement your grocery budget. So I think a good example of someone who is fairly self-sufficient is our moderator, actually, Cliff Warren. He lives on a very large piece of property. I'm not sure how many acres you have, Cliff, up in Idaho. But basically him and his wife, Sandra, are able to can, freeze, preserve what they grow in their summer garden to eat all winter long. So Cliff actually, we have a special treat coming up next week. Cliff actually is gonna share the screen with me. He's gonna be in Idaho. I'm gonna be here on next week's live stream. We're gonna meet him, talk a little bit about his garden, his philosophy of gardening, and he is a master gardener. He's a tomato expert. So he is gonna be sharing some tomato tips. So you definitely will not want to miss next week. A lot of you have known and loved Cliff for a long time here in our live streams. We're gonna actually meet him on the screen, hear his story, and hear all of his expertise. So he's definitely one of those who strives to be self-sufficient. But for your first season, I highly recommend you keep it simple. If you're a couple, you might want to go one or two raised beds. If you're a family of four, you might want to go maybe 3 to 5 raised beds. But whatever time that you have, that's something to be considered as well. And then kind of go from there and expand the next time. But don't go too fast and plant too much. Just take it easy. I do have a raised bed kitchen garden seed collection, which actually just went live on my website a couple of weeks ago. So if you're looking for the basics, a basic way to start, you may want to grab the raised bed kitchen garden seed collection. There's 15 varieties in here. Tomatoes, cucumbers, peppers, some herbs, a couple of flowers to get you started off on the right foot. So this is a great deal. This actually has 15 seed collections, like I mentioned, $24.95. So it's a little over $1 per seed packet. There's a generous amount of seeds and you can grab it today for 20% off with the code Calichem Spring Fever. And the sale does end today. So it applies to all 30 of my seed collections, my smart pots, and signed copies of my books. So grab your seed collections today, and that way you're all set for spring. And then you can also garden along with me in the Raised Bed Garden series. As we get to doing the DIY raised bed builds in a couple of weeks, that's all covered in my book, we're also going to be planting plants that came from the seed collection. So that way you can grow along with me. So first mistake, choosing the wrong location. We talked about that. Second mistake is planting too much. So don't make those mistakes and you'll be well on your way to a really successful raised bed garden. Okay, jumping back into the chat here. I want to hear what questions you have about raised bed gardening. Looks like camera guy is jumping off. And also let me know if you are able to get any seeds started yet or anything going for spring in your garden. A lot of people are getting into the whole spring fever, getting spring fever, including myself. Okay, I saw Jack had a question. Okay, Jack, question is, how do I control grass coming up inside the raised beds? Is it a problem? Will it affect the vegetables? Okay, Jack, I know you just built a whole bunch of raised beds. They look amazing. I saw your pictures on Instagram. What do you have, like 10 raised beds? So you're growing a ton of vegetables there. First off, what I like to do, and I don't know if you did this or not, but when you're first building your raised beds and filling your raised beds, I like to put cardboard on the bottom to help smother the weeds and the grass. That being said, sometimes they do push through. And when you can, you know, pull them out. You definitely don't want things getting taken over by weeds and grass, because if that happens, it will definitely affect the growth of your vegetables. However, what I found that, and I talked about this in my Refresh Your Soil, or maybe it was the benefits of raised beds in the first video in the series, is that because you're filling your beds with nice loose soil, it's very nutrient dense, if you do have weeds, they usually very easily are pulled out. So you definitely do want to keep up on that though, and don't let the weeds take over, or yes, they will smother out your vegetables. So just keep an eye on that, Jack. And I know you guys get tons of rain there in Maryland, so it could definitely be more of an issue for you than it might be for someone like myself who doesn't get quite as much rain. Okay, let's see here. I saw a couple other questions. Do you need to add mulch, from Rebecca, to the top of your raised bed? I cover that in my book as well. Highly, highly recommended. And I pretty much try and add mulch to everything I plant, because especially here in California where we have a huge water issue, if I don't add mulch to the top of my raised beds, then the soil, excuse me, dries out so much faster and I have to water a lot more. So it's a really good idea to add mulch, and you don't have to necessarily pay for mulch. You will definitely want to collect like shredded leaves in the fall if you possibly can. That's a great free resource. I've been using a lot of shredded straw lately when I run out of leaves, or just when I want something that's a little bit different. I use some shredded straw. It works very, very well. So really, really helpful for water retention. In the winter time, it does help insulate the roots of your plants from the cold. And in the summertime, it can also insulate the roots of your plants from the heat. So you can mulch on your garden beds, your raised beds, your in-ground garden. You can mulch containers. I showed in our garden tour video how you can mulch hanging baskets. So that's kind of my rule of thumb, is to mulch just about everything I plant. If I have enough mulch around. Okay, let's see here. Dawn says, I've started peppers and tomatoes. That's always fun. It's so much fun when you're coming, you know, from a long winter season, to get those seeds started indoors, and just to see them bust through the soil is always a huge, huge lift to your spirits. Okay, Charmax says, so many seeds, just a tiny bit overwhelmed. I just couldn't help it. Okay, Charmac, I think a lot of us are in that situation, because as gardeners, we're kind of addicted to plants, addicted to seeds. I'm always starting more seeds, or I'm trying not to purchase as many plants this year because I'm just trying to do it more on the affordable level. But whenever I go to the garden center, I always want to bring home more. So you're right there. I'm right there with you. Okay, the bunker thoughts. Oh, Rod's here. Hi, Rod. Great to see you. The bunker, great to see you too. Thoughts on carrots and beets, trying to germinate them outdoors in this cold weather. Okay, the bunker. They're going to germinate a little bit slower, depending on how cold we're talking. But they're going to germinate a little bit slower in cold weather. You can get them in the ground as soon as you can work the soil. You know, if your ground is frozen, you can get them in the ground as soon as you can work the soil. But they're going to germinate faster if the soil is a little bit warmer, maybe around the 50 degree range. They are both cool with the vegetables, so they're not going to like super, super warm weather or super warm soil. But 50-ish degrees, they're going to germinate a lot quicker. So go ahead and get them in if your soil is thawed out, but just keep in mind that definitely will take a little bit longer to germinate if the soil is colder. Okay, well, back in the chat in just a moment, we're going to jump into our third mistake not to make when you're growing in raised beds, and that is wrong plant placement, okay? What you want to do, kind of a good general rule of thumb, is to, a little tip that I like to follow, is called thrillers, fillers, and spillers. Whoops, dropping this here. Thrillers, fillers, and spillers. And it just kind of is a general rule of thumb to follow. I talk about that here on this page in my book. And the thrillers would be like the taller plants. You want to put those kind of in the back of your raised bed. So like I mentioned, in the northern hemisphere, you face your raised bed south. Put the taller plants in the back. Those would be the thrillers. Because if you put them in the front, guess what's going to happen? They're going to shade out all the plants behind them. So for optimal growth, you want to put the plants that are going to vine, or like things like tomatoes, cucumbers that you're going to trellis, trailing varieties of squash that you might put it on a trellis in your raised bed. You want to put those in the back. Those are the thrillers. Okay. Now the fillers are things that you'll kind of put in the middle of your raised bed. Those might be kind of medium-sized plants like peppers, maybe like eggplant, things that don't necessarily vine, but they can nicely go in the middle of your raised bed. In the wintertime, that might be things like cabbage, broccoli, cauliflower, some of your greens like kale, chard, things like that that aren't vining. You don't necessarily need a trellis for them, but they're just going to kind of hang out in there. The herbs, you know, basil, oregano, parsley, thyme, those types of vegetables, beans, not your redder beans or your pole beans, but just your regular bush beans, bush varieties of squash, all those things can kind of chill out or fill in the middle of your bed. So the spillers are things that you can really maximize your space that can spill over the side. Not only look really beautiful spilling over the sides of your raised beds, but just really can maximize the space. So those are things like you could do strawberries on the edges. You could do flowers like nasturtiums that kind of spill over the edges. Oops. You could do all kinds of things, even like trailing varieties of squash, like the scallop squash that are a little bit smaller, even like a zucchini or something like that that can kind of spill over the edge and maybe trail into your pathways. So with proper placement of your plants, you can really not only maximize your space, but maximize your harvest. Now, that being said, if you have some cool other vegetables that you kind of want to extend the season just a little bit, such as lettuce, such as an herb like cilantro that doesn't like the hot weather, sometimes they do very well in the shade of taller plants. So you might want to kind of interplant them in between your thrillers in the back, like plant your lettuce maybe in the shade of some tomatoes, or even basil doesn't always like full-on hot sun. So you can plant it in between your tomato plants to kind of give it a little bit of a break from the afternoon heat. So that's a great way to really maximize your production. Now, in my book here, I have a whole entire section, you guys, and you are going to absolutely love these 10 planting plans for your garden, and they all follow this principle. So here we have the basic kitchen garden, which actually my new seed collection is based off of this layout, including like my favorite varieties and things like that, with a illustration and then also a full-on photo of a kitchen garden. So we talked about this a little bit last week. We have the kitchen garden, we have the salsa garden, to name a few, a pizza garden layout in here, different types of raised beds, a salad station. So really by putting your plants in the best possible situation in your best possible layout in your raised beds, you can really maximize your harvest. Okay, so jump into the chat here. Let's talk about any questions that you might have going on. Hi, Rita. Great to have you on here. Rita says, I can't wait to get your new book. Thanks, Rita. Hopefully you'll be getting it in a couple of weeks. And Dorothy Skinner, how's it going, Dorothy? I have pots or long fabric bed. I need worms for them. I have a rock yard in the place I live. Okay. Let's see here. Worms, you know, in my smart pots, it's crazy enough. I've never put any worms in there, but they find their way in. It's crazy. If you create a good environment for the worms, they will find their way in, especially into fabric beds. You can add worms if you want to. You can grab like some red wiggler worms. There's sources online. You can grab red wigglers. You can add in worm castings, the Vermistera worm castings. That creates a really nice environment for the worms. And sometimes those have little tiny eggs in them. If you make your own worm castings, sometimes those have little tiny worm eggs in them. They will hatch and then really help add their own castings to the soil and just help your soil be nice and healthy. So yeah, great idea there. Okay. Hi, Kim. What is the best wood for a raised bed that will last for years? Well, funny enough, guys, I cover that all in my book too. All about the best materials to use. There's so many different types of woods out there on the market. So it really depends on your budget, what you want to spend. Cedar and redwood are probably the best woods to use they're natural pest deterrents and naturally resistant to rot. But they are also the most expensive. So if you can afford cedar or redwood, I would definitely go with that. However, pine and Douglas fir are less expensive and work just as well, will last you for years, but they just don't have that natural pest resistance or rot resistant, but they'll last you for years as well. And the price of lumber is going down just a little bit. So, hopefully, as you start to build your raised beds, you can find a really good price for building them. Okay, Chantel has a great question. What can I grow in beds that only get 2 to 4 hours of sun a day? Okay, you definitely will want to grow some of those more shade tolerant plants. And a lot of greens will tolerate shade. My herb garden actually only gets a couple of hours of sun a day. A lot of herbs will tolerate shade. Basil, parsley, cilantro grew really well in my herb garden, even over the summer, because it was just got the morning sun, a few hours, and then afternoon shade. Carrots will also grow well in partial sun. I would definitely go with the greens or the herbs. If you want to do tomatoes, I would go with a smaller, like cherry variety of tomato. The Tiny Tim is a great one to grow in partial sun, partial shade. They just don't take as much sunlight to ripen and produce harvests. You may not get as many as you would in a full sun situation, but it's definitely a better choice than growing a full-size tomato. You'll definitely get more out of it that way. So give those a try, and then let me know how things go and what you decide to plant. Okay, here, let's do one more question, and then we'll move on to our next raised bed tip here. Okay, Lou says, is there a difference between potting mix and raised bed mix? You know, all bag soils are a little bit different. You could definitely use your potting mix in your raised beds, but that sometimes tends to be just a little bit more expensive. And we're going to talk about soil in our next tip here. So just hang on to your question for just a second there. Okay, yeah, let's actually just jump into that now. So the number 4 mistake that especially first-time gardeners make or beginning gardeners make is to use poor soil in your raised beds. Now, what happens when you use poor soil? Soil is the most important thing you can invest your money into. Quality soil is going to definitely affect the quality of your plants. When I was a new gardener, I was a pretty new gardener. We found some free soil. And we went and picked it up. We had a friend with a truck who went and helped us grab a couple truckfuls. We filled a few of our raised beds with it. This was like in our first raised bed build. We might even have a YouTube video on it, I think. We filled our raised beds with it and planted my plants. I was so excited about that. I actually tell this story in my book. And I waited for months for my plants to grow. They just kind of sat there. They didn't do anything. They looked kind of sickly. They eventually turned yellow and just kind of shriveled up. And I was so disappointed because I was really looking forward to, you know, that free soil. I was on a very limited budget, couldn't afford to buy a lot of soil, but it was really, really disappointing. So the soil is the biggest investment that you can make into your plants. Poor soil usually means plants that aren't very healthy, that aren't going to thrive. So you do not want to make the same mistake that I did. I'm trying to save you making that mistake and that disappointment. So that being said, I have lots of ways I hear in my book, lots of DIY recipes that you can fill your raised beds on the cheap. So a couple really important components of soil. The cheapest, number one, cheapest isn't always the best. Sorry, I got my notes here because there's so many good tips. I don't want to forget to tell you any. So some really important components of soil. Number one being aeration. You want your soil to be nice and light and fluffy. You want your plants getting the air that it needs. If you just fill your bed, say, with really heavy clay soil, your plants aren't getting good aeration, and the roots need oxygen in order to, you know, take up the water and nutrients and be able to breathe. It's very, very important. So in your aeration, you also need moisture retention. So you don't want the soil just completely, or the water just completely draining out the soil. You want a good balance of aeration and moisture retention. So the moisture, the soil will retain moisture and stay around the roots of the plants. And then it will be able to take up the water and the nutrients that it needs. And the third thing that's really important is to have soil that has good nutrients in it. If your soil is completely devoid of nutrients, which I'm pretty sure that soil that I got for free was had nothing in it. It was just kind of dead soil. I don't even know what was in it, but it didn't work. Had lots of heavy wood chips and things like that. So if it has no good nutrients in it, then your plants are not going to thrive. Now, I have a couple plants here. This is filled with my DIY seed starting mix. So it's got coco core in it. It's got some worm casting. Coco core is the water retention, the aeration. It's got worm castings, which are the nutrition, and it's got worm castings and vermiculite, which is a water retention component of the soil. So the better your soil, the better off the health of your plants. Now, that being said, in my book, I've got some DIY recipes. A basic DIY soil recipe would be take some topsoil from your yard, or you can purchase topsoil, bag topsoil, or maybe topsoil in bulk at the garden or at a landscape company, and fill your raised bed with half of your native topsoil from your yard. Don't fill it completely full with that. And we're gonna add in some nutrients, which would be the compost. So if you have compost, you can then top off the raised bed with compost, mix that in together. So you have half topsoil, half compost. And then you can, and the compost will also add aeration to your soil as well. And then you wanna put some worm castings on top. So I would say like in a 4x8 raised bed, you might wanna use like one of the 10 pound bags of worm castings. That way you have all the components of healthy soil there. You have the aeration, you have the moisture retention with the compost also helps with that, and you have the nutrition, the compost and the worm castings as well. And I've got other DIY soil recipes in my book too that use different components of bagged soil. You can do all bagged soil if you want, like an all raised bed mix if you want to, but that can get a little bit expensive. So there's lots of different ways that you can save money in your raised beds, and I have a whole chapter on that in my book. Okay, you know what? I don't really want to comment necessarily on different soil brands. There's lots of good ones out there that you can use, and I can't really, you know, I haven't used all of them out there, so I can't really say if Dr. Earth's is better or not. I primarily use good dirt soil. I've used it for years. It's my favorite. I've just found that it's superior than other soils. If you already have soil in your raised bed, did a whole video on how to refresh your raised bed soil. You don't have to dump it all out season after season. Or you can add some of the good dirt soil conditioner is a really good thing to add a bag on top of your raised beds just to kind of top it off. Or, you know, grab a raised bed soil mix at the garden center and top it off with that, kind of mix it in a little bit. It's really easy to do, but it is very, very important that you have high quality soil. The best that you can afford, you know, if you can't afford a full on raised bed full of bag soil, definitely don't do that. Landscape companies often sell in bulk for about $35 or $40 a load. And there's lots of different ways that you can fill your bed with trees, sticks, leaves, other things. So you're not filling your entire bed with soil, which can get very, very expensive. Okay, so let me make sure I covered everything on that. I think I did. All right, let's see here. Okay, let's jump into the chat then. We've covered four tips so far for mistakes not to make. And let's see what kind of questions you might have from what we've covered so far. Charlene Mitchell, compost has increased in price so much. Yeah, everything is increasing right now. So it's kind of crazy. So look for different ways that you can save money. If you have a landscape company in your area that sells soil, highly recommend doing that. If you can beg, borrow, or steal a friend's truck, don't steal, but borrow a friend's truck if you don't have one. That's a very, very cost-effective way to either purchase a load of compost to mix into your raised beds, or a lot of times, like I know the one near us has something called a veggie mix. And then I'll bulk that up or add most of that to my raised beds and then add some amendments to kind of bulk that up just a little bit. So look around and see what you can find in your area where you can get products for bulk and that you'll save a lot of money. Okay, let's see here. Can you use the same soil each season in smart pots and raised beds as long as you amend them? Mama Jack, you absolutely can. Go back and watch the Raised Bed Garden series from the beginning. Did a whole video on that last week on how to refresh your raised bed soil. Big investment. You definitely don't want to waste it or dump it out every year. You just need to amend it and top it off. Amy says, hi, Kim. I've watched so many of your videos. I learned so much. So excited to finally tune in live. Well, welcome, Amy. It's great to have you on here. Just started tomatoes, kale, and herbs here in Zone 5B from seeds I bought from you last fall. Wow, thanks a lot, Amy. So glad you're here. And thank you so much for supporting my seed shop. And like I mentioned, if you need more seeds, 20% off. Today is the last day with Cali Kim Spring Fever discount. And even though my book will not ship for another week, grab your signed copy. If you're thinking about getting a signed copy in the next month or so, grab your copy now with the 20% off, and we'll be shipping them out next week. That way you can save save a little bit of money that way. Oh, and I do have these bundled together at a $5. The price on my website is already $5 off, but an additional 20% off, you'll save even more money. And by the way, I try and put a lot of extra care into each package I send out. We hand pack all of our orders here in-house. We hand pack all of our seeds. We're a small family-owned business. Every single order receives this little postcard with a little free seed packet attached. And we switch out these free seed packets from time to time. And you also get a coupon with every order. This month's April's coupon is for 25% off your next order. So if you miss one of my sales, you can use this for a discount on your next order. I also have some little goodies I've been including lately. I don't know how long we'll be able to keep doing this because we're almost out of them. But every order gets a little magnet you can put on the refrigerator. And right now we're also sending out Cali Kim sticky notes with every order as well. So you don't just get seeds, you get a lot of special attention and a personal note from me with every single order. So definitely get over there and order. We try and give personal attention and we ship within 24 hours, Monday through Friday. The weekend orders are usually shipped out on Tuesdays. We prep everything on Mondays and then ship them on Tuesdays. So we really try and get things to you as soon as possible because I know how anxious you all are to get your seeds planted in the ground. Okay, so last tip for today, last mistake that you definitely don't want to make, especially if you're a first-time raised bed gardener, is don't make the mistake of putting no irrigation in your garden beds, okay? We talked about being close to a water source because you're much more apt to keep up on your watering. If you don't live in an area where you get rain consistently, I know a lot of you do live like on the East Coast area where you might get rain every day. If you live in an area like myself where we might get rain a few times a year, you've got to do drip irrigation in your garden beds, if at all possible. And the reason for that is, if you're not consistent with your watering, you're not going to get consistent results. We all just have busy lives, right? We all have a million things to do. If you're like me, you're always on the go doing something. There's way too much that we're trying to pack into our days. And you're gonna forget to water, or you're not gonna have time to water. Your beds are gonna dry out. Your plants are gonna get stunted. They're not gonna be as productive. So do yourself a favor. It's not that hard. It's not that expensive. I promise you, install drip irrigation in your raised beds and your garden will thank you for it. It takes a little bit of doing to figure it out the first time. But once you do, you're going to say, why did I not do this sooner? You can install a timer, which will go off automatically. No matter if you're on vacation, we're able to go on vacation every year, leave our garden. We usually go for about 10 days on vacation in the fall when things slow down a little bit. And we're able to go every year and really no one has to come and check out and watch over my garden. Everything goes off like clockwork. And things look pretty good for the most part when we get back. So it'll save you time, water, and money. Now, we have tons of videos on installing drip irrigation in containers, in raised beds, in garden beds. So just look up my drip irrigation playlist. And it's basically the same principles of installing it no matter where you install it. You can even install it in hanging baskets. I'm very, very big on drip irrigation. So I do have a whole section in my book on watering. First of all, on mulching, on watering, when to water, how do you know when to water, and then a whole little section on drip irrigation. My first book, Organic Gardening for Everyone, has a very detailed explanation on how to install drip irrigation. So if that's something that you want to do, I highly recommend it. Your garden will thank you, and you won't believe how much time it gives you back to do other things that you might enjoy, like planting, harvesting, grilling and cooking up some of your vegetables, or just having friends over and spending time with your friends. Nisha, spending time with your friends, cooking your vegetables or preparing your vegetables. Nisha says drip irrigation has saved my garden. And yes, absolutely. It is a huge, huge time saver. And just something that, you know, a lot of people are intimidated about, but definitely dive right in. I do have a drip irrigation system I've used for years. I want to say 10 years, called Dig. I think it's in the video description, linked up in the video description. You can grab it on Amazon. It's also over at, I know our local Home Depot has it. And what's great about it is it has different things that you can connect and expand your system. So you start small and you want to expand, you can easily expand your system to like new containers, new raised beds, and new in-ground gardens. So anything can be attached to drip irrigation. It's definitely highly, highly recommended. Okay, my backyard gourds, a free way to do drip watering. I use a gallon jug, pop bottles with two holes, fill with water and place the cap. Their water will drip slowly throughout the day. Great idea. I love that. It saves you money. It saves you time. And that works great if you have a small area that you want to irrigate. So great suggestion. Thank you so much for sharing that, my backyard gourds. I appreciate that. Okay, let's scroll back here and see if there's any questions before we sign off for the day. Dorothy Skinner, I've been making my own olives to help with the Arizona heat. So that's something similar to what my backyard gourds mentioned. Olives are a way that you can make your kind of a self-watering type of container out of milk jugs, or I think olives might be like maybe a clay pot or a wine bottle or something like that that you turn upside down. That will help kind of make that a self-watering system. Okay, Madiza Raza, can I use hay bales in the bottom of my raised beds? It's 22 inches in height. Okay, I would not recommend using hay. I would recommend using straw. The reason why is hay has a lot of weed seeds. So those weed seeds are going to poke up through your raised bed. But straw, straw is harvested at a different time or something like that. I forget why it doesn't have weed seeds, but it doesn't. So that is something that you could spread in the bottom of your raised beds to help fill up some of that space. You can buy straw bales very inexpensively at your local like feed shop, tractor supply, that type of thing. So very inexpensive. I did see a lot of people asking, and they asked on the garden tour video about the straw mulch that I use. And I didn't mean to mention that in the video, I forgot. But Kevin over at Epic Gardening, so I believe his website is epicgardening.com, sells that straw. I absolutely love it. It's super lightweight, it's clean, so you're not having anything else in there that's not supposed to be in there. It's shredded. The bags are really, really packed full of straw. So you do have to spend some money on it, but you get a lot in there. I think I might have got one of his sales last spring or last fall, and I got like 2 bags for 1 or something like that, and they really go a long way. The great thing I love about that is it does break down over time into the garden beds, so that you are also adding organic matter as you're mulching as well, and then you just can go in there and refresh the mulch when you need to add more. So that is a great product. I highly recommend it if you're looking for something like that to purchase. Okay, let's see here. Melissa says, I found that straw doesn't break down nearly as fast as I expected to. I still have 100% of last year's mulch on my grow bags and they don't require replacement. Okay, great tip there, Melissa. So that definitely doesn't, straw, at least the straw bales don't break down as quickly as the leaves do. So if that's a concern for you, that might be something that you would want to look at too. The clean straw though, I found it may stay a little bit longer than the leaves, but it does tend to break down as well. But it's also, you know, more finely shredded than like the straw bales that you could buy. So, you know, you just kind of have to make a decision, see which one works best for you and what, you know, what which one that you like the best. Okay, guys, we're gonna go ahead and sign off for today. What a great live stream, a great group here today. We have 224 people watching, at least on my screen. So I really appreciate you taking time out of your Monday to hang out with me. I do live stream every Mondays at noon Pacific time. And don't forget, Cliff, our moderator, is gonna be on with me next week, answering your tomato questions, sharing his expert tomato tips. It is a live stream you are not gonna wanna miss. Especially those of you that have appreciated Cliff's assistance here in the chat. It's going to be really fun to meet him, hear a little bit more about his story. So looking forward to having Cliff on next week. And don't forget the 20% off sale ends today with the code CALLIKIMTHINKSPRING over at CALLIKIMGARDENHOME.com. All right, guys, have a wonderful Monday and a wonderful next wonderful rest of your week. And we'll see you on next Monday's live stream. Bye-bye.